I'll just share my screen to start with. Hope everyone can see the screen.
Absolutely. Go ahead.
Okay. Just want to kind of give a brief introduction. Tejbir has already shared. In addition to being a mountaineer, professionally I'm a software engineer, and recently I also got myself a nutrition coaching certification. So I'm also a nutrition coach. I believe in the way of science and evidence-based backed mindset, and I have also gotten recently into bodybuilding. So I am also a novice bodybuilder. Not going to spend a lot of time into any of this, but this is not how I had always been. This is where I started from, and my point here is that hundreds of people from India have climbed Everest, and thousands of people across the world have climbed Everest. So there's nothing unique in that sense about climbing Everest anymore, as it used to be maybe 30, 40 years ago when it was like a very, very big achievement. At the same time, each one of us has our own personal journeys and our own kind of personal life transformations that we go through when we go on such journeys. And so for me, I started from here. And before I went into the vegan bit and kind of spoke about a little bit about my preparation and all of those things, I did want to kind of share how I discovered my love for mountains. I mean, look, I come from a Gujarati family, and back in 2008 and 2009, I used to be 110 kilos, almost, obese, probably 40 kilos overweight, and a software engineer sitting in front of a computer all day long and just, typing away to glory. And then what changed? I'll kind of, share this small story. In 2009, my wife Dipti and I decided that we wanted to see some snow. Dipti had never seen snow in her entire life. And for me, it had almost been 30 years or maybe even 25 years since I had seen some snow. So we decided, what's the place we can go to? So we Googled and we realized maybe Shimla or Manali is a great destination. We were like typical tourists. So we signed up to go to Shimla in the winters of 2009, that is February of 2009. We reached Shimla. We didn't realize what we had signed up for. We got to Shimla and हमारे होटल का हीटर नहीं चल रहा था, हमारे होटल में पानी नहीं आ रहा था, गर्म पानी. And we were like, what the heck is going on, man? Why did we even come on a vacation like this? I mean, of course, now when I look back upon those days, of course, my life in a 4x4 tent is amazing luxury. So looking back upon those days, I was still a very, tourist. And I remember for the first 6 days in Shimla, nothing happened. It would get overcast every day, but there would be no snowfall and nothing. So it was time to go back home. And on the last day, I remember roaming around the Shimla market, and we met this driver and he said, "I will show you snow." So I'm like, take our money, take us to snow. And so he said, "We'll drive to Narkanda." And so we drove to Narkanda, and I remember reaching Narkanda and being surrounded by these amazing peaks all across. But I told my driver, "Boss, हमें तो स्नो को हाथ लगाना है, ये ऐसे स्नो को दूर से नहीं देखना है." So then our driver is like, "Okay, I am taking you to this place called Hattu Peak." And so we started driving towards Hattu Peak, and I remember we had this Maruti Zen car, and about half a kilometer into the drive, we ran into almost about a feet of snow, and his car just couldn't go further. So he's like, "Saab, aapko snow dekhna tha. We are here in snow. Now go enjoy." And I still remember me and Dipti like going in the snow and just enjoying our time, making snowballs, throwing at each other. We were almost like a kids in a candy store kind of a thing. And then I don't know what happened, but I told Dipti, "We have enjoyed. Let's, just walk a little further, have this, nice walk and enjoy our time." And I remember we started walking. I think the route to the top of Hattu Peak is about 8 kilometers, the driving route. And we told our driver we'll come back in 15 minutes. But we walked for an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours. And I remember at the end of 4th hour, we were standing on the very top of Hattu Peak. And for me, if you ask me that one moment that changed the entire direction of my life, I think it has to be that moment in February of 2009. it was so quiet on top of Hatu Peak. It was only two of us with a mountain dog with us, and not a single soul in miles and miles of wherever we could see. I remember distinctly, I could hear every single heartbeat of mine. For a second, I was so scared that I thought, you know, that Dipti could hear my heartbeat. For me, I felt truly alive. I felt this deep happiness. And for that, in that moment, I realized that I stopped thinking about the future. I stopped planning for the future. I stopped wondering about my mistakes in past. And I was able to exist in this microsecond of the moment. And to myself, I promised that this is the state of the mind that I want to probably be in for the rest of my life. And believe me, it never started off by, you know, I want to climb mountains or I want to climb Everest, but it just started by, I want to be in this state of mind for rest of my life. And I thought, when I go back home, I'm such a passionate technologist, I'm building out this startup in Mumbai, and I would really feel that challenge. I would really feel the same way about my work. Unfortunately, I never felt like that about my work. And from that next 1.5 year, I went back to the mountains all the time, doing short day weekend trips to Chopta, to places in Himachal, to places anywhere I could find in Mumbai, anywhere I could find mountains, I went back. And truly speaking, that is where I kind of fell in love with mountains. Eventually going on a trip to Everest Base Camp, seeing Everest. I still remember that evening, a sunset was happening on Everest. We were camped at this place called the Pumori Base Camp. And last rays of sunset were directly falling on Everest. Every other mountain near Everest, Lhotse, Noobse, entire range. Everest is such a gigantic range, and every mountain was in the color of gray and blue. But Everest in the middle was burning golden in color. And when I saw Everest this way, in my mind, I had found the dream of my life. I had found the calling of my life. I knew that I am going to stand on top of the world. I promised myself, and I went back home. And kind of just wanted to take a step back and share one of the biggest takeaways from my entire last decade plus long journey. I do think that for me, at least, finding my Everest kind of gave me the drive and focus and the passion to relentlessly pursue this, go on this journey, and kind of, you know, transform my life. And I truly believe that if each one of us finds our Everest and we go on this journey, we will have the same passion, we'll have the same focus, and we'll have the drive to kind of, you know, achieve our dreams and passions. And today, you know, when I ask a lot of my 40-year-old friends, hey, you know, what's your Everest? And most of them just have no clue. They are like, oh, hum to job kar rahe, hame to paisa kamana hai, bas yehi hamara Everest hai. And I'm like, but what's your Everest? What drives you? What makes you wake up every single morning? What, you know, gives you that enjoyment, that happiness, that true, you know, like, ke main is cheez ke liye paida hua. What gives you that? And I think most of them simply, I'm not judging any of them. I'm not judging anyone who doesn't have an Everest in life. But I truly believe that if you have an Everest in life, it will give you that passion, it will give you that drive, it will give you that happiness. So that's kind of, you know, my biggest takeaway, that find your Everest and then go on that journey to kind of climb that Everest. But I also remember from the same trip back in 2010, when I was at Everest Base Camp or Pumori Base Camp, I remember walking inside the dining tent on one of the evenings, and on the right-hand side of the tent, there was this big wall with many photos of dead bodies and people's hands that were amputated, people's fingers that were amputated. And I looked at my expedition leader and I told him, Tim, what is this? You know, do you want us to climb Everest, or like you are trying to scare us away from here? And Tim told me, I still remember, you know, like the words that he told me, Kuntal, if you don't train, if you don't prepare yourself, if you take all of this lightly, then there is a good chance that you will die on Everest. And then there is a good chance that you will also be part of this wall that I have created. And so I asked him at that point, Tim, what's the secret behind climbing Everest, or what's the secret behind kind of, you know, achieving some of the biggest dreams of your life when it comes to mountain climbing. And I still remember Tim telling me this statement, Kuntal, to climb to the top of the world, you need a top of the world body and you need a top of the world mind. And that always has been the ethos of my entire training and preparation journey from the last 10 years of creating that top of the world body and mind. And I also happened to read a book by Ed Vistours, the American mountaineer, called No Shortcuts to the Top. And that book is also something that I use as a mindset, where I really decided I'm not going to take any shortcuts to the top. Also in the beginning, the topic of the conversation is climbing Everest the vegan way. And to kind of backtrack, in 2002, I decided to become a vegan. I used to be a vegetarian and I decided that I'll go vegan. And this is primarily driven by my ethics around the cause of animal rights and the cause of animal justice. In 2010, I remember when I was talking to my expedition leader and a whole bunch of people from the mountaineering community, and I said that I want to climb Everest as a vegan. Most of them said, you know, kind of, Everest is not possible to climb without eating meat, without eating eggs, without eating paneer, without eating cheese. And I started looking at most successful climbers, including Indian vegetarian climbers, and including all the climbers from around the world, what they were eating. And I quickly realized that most of them were eating a lot of meat, a lot of dairy, a lot of cheese, a lot of paneer, and just their diets were filled with animal foods. And they were wearing animal clothing. Everyone was wearing leather. Everyone was wearing wool. Everyone was wearing feather jackets. And I'm like, man, this seems like tough. Like any smart human being, I went on the Google and I asked Google, hey, climbing Everest as a vegan, is it possible? And till date, it has never happened with me in my entire life that you ask Google a question and it gives you zero responses. But I even saw that day where, you know, Google gave me zero responses. There was no vegan who had climbed Everest. So there was no precedent. But I promised myself that I was going to climb vegan. I was going to climb Everest as a vegan, or I was not going to climb it at all. And just to kind of share some of the foundation steps in terms of my training, in the last 10 years, I would have easily done about 1,000 plus hikes in the Western Ghats in Maharashtra, easily about 35 to 40 plus expeditions in the Himalaya. These range from treks to 5,000 meters, trek to 5,500 meters, about 15 plus 6,000 meter mountains, 4 plus 8,000 meter mountains, tons of 7,000 meter attempts. I have climbed in wide variety of terrains, rock, ice, snow, in inclement bad weather, in pitch darkness. I have even simulated conditions where I have tied one of my hands behind my back so that I'm just climbing with one hand. I have even simulated conditions where I'm climbing for more than 24 hours without drinking any food or without drinking any water or without eating any food. And a lot of this just to kind of get myself mentally prepared of what could potentially happen to me on a bigger mountain, where if I got lost or if I kind of got injured, then how would I survive? If I can't even do it at sea level or at 1,000 meters, then how was I going to do it at 9,000 meters on top of Everest? That was, you know, simply not going to work. So I did whatever I could in the 10 plus years. And a lot of people reach out to me asking, hey, how should I get into mountaineering? How should I climb, you know, a mountain like Everest or a big mountain? And I always tell them that kind of build superhuman level physical fitness, combine them with a lot of mountaineering skills, do a mountaineering course, do a lot of practice on rock, ice, snow, as and when you can. And then combine that with tons and tons of actual practical experience of just climbing mountains all the time. And that, I think, is going to make you a well-rounded mountaineer and potentially not be a liability to the team, or, you know, just be a reliable mountaineer, be a safe mountaineer, someone who's going to come back home with all their fingers and toes intact. So I'm not going to go into details of my training preparation more than this, or even my diet from that matter. Before, you know, this call started, I was speaking to Vinayak, I remember, and he was asking that, he was very interested in learning about my diet. Believe me, vegan food was last of my problem in climbing Everest. as long as you are eating a well-balanced diet, as long as you are being smart about just eating enough food, vegan food is not a problem. And for everyone who's joining in, who's wondering what vegan is, vegan means I am a vegetarian, but I also don't eat anything that comes from an animal. So no doodh, ghee, dahi, butter, cheese, paneer, eggs. I don't wear leather. I don't wear wool. I don't wear silk. I don't wear any kind of feather jackets, nothing. So nothing that comes from an animal, I will either consume or I'll put it on my body. It wasn't really hard in terms of a vegan diet. If people have questions at the end, I can definitely answer those. But for now, I'm just kind of going to skip over the diet piece. Just kind of, you know, make a comment that it is absolutely easy. If anything, a lot of people say, tum to sirf survive kar rahe hoge Everest pe, you know, aisa sab khana khake. My answer always is I didn't survive. I was actually thriving on this diet. I don't want to boast or anything, but I think in last 4 or 5 years, any 8,000 meter mountains that I've climbed, reliably, I have been possibly one of the best climbers on the team on every single of that expedition. And that kind of goes to just show that diet is not a problem as long as you are being smart about it, as long as you plan it, and as long as you also have trained on that very diet and that you have put in time. You can't just wake up one day and say, I'm going to Everest climb kar raha aur wo main vegan ki tarah karunga. That's not how it works. So just to kind of share some photos from my journey, since I'm a photographer as well, and I'll just share some photos and kind of, you know, share some of the small stories. I still remember this is one of the first nights I had spent at Everest Base Camp. And believe me, every night that I spent at Everest Base Camp, I could see the Milky Way around 3:30 in the morning. It was nice in the sky at just, you know, at this angle. When the first time I saw it, I was so enamored by it. But now that I almost spent 100 plus days at the Everest Base Camp sleeping there, this is just like something that happens every night. And it's such an amazing scene. And of course, the south side of Everest is famous for Khumbu Icefall between Base Camp and Camp 1. So this is, you know, some of the pictures that I have shot in the Khumbu Icefall. And then we have, once you kind of cross Khumbu Icefall and get to Camp 1 and get your first sight of Everest and Lhotse in front of you. I still remember when I first came to this moment and I saw Everest in front of me. In some ways, I was so shocked because I was expecting a big snow mountain in front of me. But there was this big black rock giant in front of me. And I was like, what? Like, I was just so taken aback by this scene, but it is so amazing, the kind of vantage point from camp vantage points of Everest that at least I have ever experienced. And some of the climbing is just so spectacular. You are among some of the majestic mountains out there. And again, nights are always spectacular. The colors are just insane. Sometimes it's, you know, lavender, sometimes it's blue, sometimes it's like mix, you know, when Milky Way is in the sky. It's so fascinating to kind of spend. Most people are so cold, but as a photographer, you kind of have to come out, you have to kind of shoot and be there out in the nights. And I truly believe the beauty of Himalaya comes out so nicely during the nights. And then again, between Camp 1 and Camp 2, you have these big walls. Every year, of course, the terrain changes. And this photo specifically is from 2018. And then, of course, as you move to Camp 3, you have this massive Lhotse wall. And there's always, I mean, Everest is a commercial mountain. So there's always tons of people on this mountain. And but then there are also times where you are just alone because you maybe, you know, went later in the day or you went earlier in the morning. And there's hardly anyone in these sections and you're just, you know, kind of to yourself. This is between Camp 3 and Camp 4 as you kind of start accessing an area called the Geneva Spur. And then finally, this is, you know, kind of getting into the summit push. This is me right below the South Summit. I summited on May 19th in 2016. And I remember back then it was a record because 201 people summited on the same date. And it was a crazy traffic day. I must have spent easily about 4 or 5 hours behind traffic. And every time the traffic rested, I remember overtaking a lot of them. Kind of at one point even foregoing not changing my oxygen bottle because I just wanted to overtake them. And I was kind of happy, you know, not even sucking on oxygen, just, you know, walk, overtake anyone as I could so that I could be, you know, in traffic free zones. And finally, you know, one of the very spectacular scenes as you kind of reach South Summit, and then finally you can kind of get the first views of the real summit of Everest, because all the time you are at South Col, you can see the top of Everest and you think that is the top of Everest, but that is actually the South Summit, and top of Everest is kind of hidden. And for most of you who are wondering whether there's Hillary Step exists or not, I have to tell you, I have crossed this section in 2016 after the 2015 earthquake. I can definitively say that Hillary Step no longer exists. The two big boulders that define Hillary Step, I think they were dislodged probably either during the earthquake or I don't know when. But it's no longer Hillary Step now. We call it the Hillary Slope because there's a nice ice slope that has kind of formed around that area. And then finally, you start taking the final steps towards the top of Everest. You can kind of see Lhotse bang in the behind. I still remember standing on the summit of Everest and kind of seeing Lhotse on one side and then Makalu on one side, and deciding that my next mountain is going to be Lhotse and then my next mountain is going to be Makalu. So I've climbed Lhotse, but I've not climbed Makalu yet. This is finally the top of Everest. And then finally, just, you know, sharing some pictures from my Lhotse summit as well. In the background, you can see the massive Everest, you know, triangular face, the one that we end up climbing through the night. So here I am at the start of the Rees Couloir on Lhotse. And this is me inside the Rees Couloir. We are, you know, kind of very, very close to the summit. Finally, starting to climb the final 40 feet rock wall that leads to the top of Lhotse. Again, quite an amazing, quite a spectacular climb. We had a great summit day in May 2018. This was May 15th. And this is my summit photo of Everest. And this is, of course, May 19th, 2016. And why am I showing this photo? Well, first off, I had promised myself that I would climb Everest as a vegan. But when I stood on the summit of Everest, unfortunately, I was wearing this jacket and I was wearing these mittens in my hand. And this jacket is made from down feathers, and these mittens are made from leather and down feathers both. And even though I had promised myself I would climb to the top of Everest as a vegan, unfortunately, these two pieces of gear made my climb I would say it was not a vegan climb in that sense. While my diet was 100% vegan, every other piece of my gear was 100% vegan, but these two pieces of gear were not vegan, unfortunately. Starting from 2012, I had started writing to some of the biggest gear companies in the world, North Face, Patagonia, Mountain Hardware. Even I wrote to Primaloft, which is known for synthetic insulation. I wrote to RAB, I wrote to PhD Designs, I wrote to any company that I could find. And I would always write to them saying, hey, can you build synthetic gear for me? Can you build any animal-free gear for me? I remember every year I would get, you know, responses from these companies saying the technology is not there. It is financially not viable. You are literally the only human in the entire world demanding for this gear for on top of Everest. It's just not going to happen. In 2015, I was talking to one of my gear manufacturers, a local gear manufacturer in Nepal, and I was telling him, can you create a suit for me, which is just made from synthetic insulation that is locally available in Nepal? And I remember this person telling me that if I create a suit for you, then you will literally look like a big ball on the mountain. It will be impractical. It will be very, very heavy. And it will actually put you at a lot of risk on top of Mount Everest. You may not even just get to the top, or you may kind of, you know, be in trouble while getting on the top, which is when I kind of made this one time choice that I will wear the non-vegan gear that I have and I will reach the top of Everest. And that is what did. I did, but every single day since 2019, I have questioned my decision. And I came to a conclusion that 2016 climb was one of the biggest failures of my life. And you may be shocked hearing at this statement, but in my mind, it was the biggest failure of my life because I gave up. I gave up building the gear. I gave up on, you know, my ethics. And I just couldn't, I had lost all my sleep and I felt guilty a lot. But I decided that I will not give up. So I continued writing to a lot of gear companies across the world. But you may ask me, what is the problem with down? What is the problem with feathers? Please understand, this is what happens in the down insulation manufacturing industry. Geese, which are sentient beings, they are just taken by their neck. Their necks are broken. All their feathers are removed. And then those feathers are stuffed. And that is what makes your feather jackets. All the feather jackets that we are all wearing, they are unfortunately feathers of a different animal, of an animal that wanted to live. And most of the times, the industry is so unethical that they actually just pluck the feathers from a live geese. They don't even kill the geese. They just pluck the feathers. Geese are in tremendous amount of pain. They get infections and they actually die a worse kind of a death in that industry. So I truly do not believe that it is ethical to wear down. And which is why where this my belief stems from. In 2017, I ended up reaching out to a company called Save the Duck. Save the Duck is an Italian gear manufacturer and they make synthetic insulation. And I wrote to them saying, I want to climb Everest and I would like you to make a one-piece Himalayan suit for me. And like every time I expected them to, you know, get back to me saying, Kuntal, it is not possible. But to my surprise, they said it is possible and they are willing to do the research and development to create this suit. They think that they had the technology. So I remember that we did about 8 months of back and forth, 8 months of design, back and forth, research and development. And finally, in April of 2018, the first ever synthetic suit of the world was ready. And I decided that I'm going to climb Mount Lhotse using that suit. One of the last challenges that had remained is creating the mittens. I could have easily asked Save the Duck to create mittens for me as well, but I didn't want to kind of overburden them. They already had a big challenge of creating one of the first synthetic suits of the world. And so I decided to again reach out to my friend in Kathmandu, who was the gear manufacturer. And I said, let's get Primaloft insulation. We'll just get the insulation. We'll have a nylon layer on top of that. And we will create our own mittens. We'll stitch them and we'll tailor them ourselves. And both me and him sat down and designed this mitten, even though I didn't understand the design concepts behind gear, but I had sufficiently used mittens for almost 6 years. So I realized what I wanted in my mitten in terms of functionality and in terms of warmth. So we sat down and decided this is how the mittens are going to look like. And we got that mitten tailored from a local guy in Kathmandu. And finally, the last two pieces of gear that simply I could not have an alternative for, I finally had an alternative for. The bigger challenge was that no testing had been done on these alternatives. Like if you look at a North Face jacket, it undergoes testing for years and years and years by some of the top kind of, you know, mountaineers in the world. And for my gear, there was zero amount of testing that had been done even beyond minus 10 degrees Celsius. But I told that I am going to be the guinea pig for this. I am going to wear this gear. I am going to test it out. If a guy who lives in Mumbai year round in plus 40 degrees Celsius, if that guy can climb to the top of Everest or can climb to the top of Lhotse in difficult conditions while wearing this gear and stay warm, I'm pretty confident that this gear could work for anyone on this planet, because most Western mountaineers anyways don't need to kind of, you know, deal with cold as much as we do, especially, you know, people from West India and South India. So I thought maybe, hey, you know, I'm going to be the tester. I climbed Lhotse on top on May 15th. And believe me, I was warm and cozy. And both these pieces of gear worked optimum. On the contrary, I can share the email with you. The first email that I wrote to Save the Duck was, your jacket is too warm. I was sweating inside the jacket, and that sweat was making me cold. You need to decrease the amount of insulation that you have added and make the jacket a little lighter. That was my feedback to them. So one of the first synthetic jackets in the world had to be actually redone to make it a little lighter. So my jacket, in comparison to a Mountain Hardwear jacket suit, was about 800 grams heavier. And my mittens were potentially about 100 grams heavier than a regular typical mitten that you would find. My mittens also had other functional issues, that they were not gripping very well on the ropes. But that issue can definitely just be fixed by having a Kevlar wrist palm. And that is not a very, very, you know, big deal, in my opinion. So again, understanding that I had this jacket now and that I could, you know, climb mountains in a 100% animal-free fashion, I decided that it was time to go back to climb Everest. And I chose the Chinese side, and I chose the Chinese side for a very specific reason. Chinese side is known to be windier, and Chinese side is known to be colder. Just because North Face tends to be windier, North Face of most mountains tends to be windier, it also tends to be colder. So I decided I'll climb from the Chinese side, and that will be a much kind of a harsher and a tougher test of my jacket, and a tougher test of its warmth and of its functionality. And here are some photos from my climb from 2019. And this is me on first on the left side, about 10 minutes below the summit, and then finally on the summit. Believe me, both the jacket and the mittens worked very optimum. And a lot of people ask me, what was I wearing inside inside my down suit? I was wearing two layers of thermals from a company called Sherpa. Sherpa is a Nepalese company, and I was wearing two synthetic thermals on my top, and I was wearing one synthetic bottom from Patagonia. So just that much. And on top of that, I had a synthetic suit. So you can imagine that I really did not require a lot of kind of gear, and temperatures were, I think, pretty close to minus 30 or minus 35 C on our summit morning. So pretty good temperatures to test in, while wind was not so high. I would say about 10 kilometers per hour was the wind. So I would not say probably the best test conditions, but still, I never felt cold throughout the entire night. Heck, for most of my ascent later on and most of my descent, I had actually removed my mittens. It was simply too warm inside these mittens. So in that sense, I think the jacket and the mittens worked pretty well. So in 2019 is when I truly finished my dream of climbing Everest in a vegan fashion. And I want to make this statement that I truly, from the bottom of my heart, believe that no animals need to suffer, die, or be exploited for our existence or for our dreams to come true. And I'll just, you know, kind of end with this final kind of a point. A lot of people ask me, why do I climb these mountains? And yes, there are many, many, many reasons why we climb these mountains. But for me, one of the big reasons why I climb these mountains is my relationship with this guy and my relationship with the entire Sherpa community in Nepal. I truly, truly, truly believe that Sherpa people, Sherpa guides, and the entire Sherpa community is the true hero, are the true Superman, are the true superstars, are the real stars of the show when it comes to 99.99% of big mountain climbing in Nepal, or even in Pakistan, or even in Tibet. Without help of these people, without support of these people, I think barring one or two people who climb every year on their own, I think each, every single one of us kind of, you know, needs to credit these people. Without these people, we would simply never make it to the top or never achieve our dreams. And for me, I have climbed every single mountain, every single big mountain of my life with Mingma. In the last 6 years, he has been my climbing partner. He has been my guide. He has been my mentor. My camaraderie with him, the way he shows up, the prepared he is, the amount of patience he comes in, the amount of humility he comes in with. And this is the same guy who fixed the ropes to the top of K2 this winter. He is the guy who was part of team Nims Dai, and he was also the leading the rope fixing effort. And he is the very same guy who put the final rope to the summit of Mount Everest. And the kind of humility, the kind of preparedness, the kind of mentality that guy comes with, I am inspired by him every single time I spend, you know, days with him to become a better version of myself, to become a stronger climber, to become a better climber. And truly speaking, in some sense, this is why I go and climb mountains, because I truly enjoy climbing mountains with him. I truly enjoy spending home in the, you know, my time away from home in my second home with my second family, which is Himalaya and Mi'kmaq. And again, without help of Mi'kmaq, I would simply have never made it to the top of any of the mountains that I've climbed in the last 6-7 years. He has been a bedrock of support. He becomes, as I said, my friend, my mentor, my guide. Sometimes he becomes my mother and my father, and takes care of me like his own baby and protects me. I remember, you know, those gloves that I showed you, the ones that were leather and down gloves, those gloves were actually not mine. Those gloves were his, because my gloves started malfunctioning about 600 feet below the summit of Everest in 2016. And I remember him removing his gloves without thinking even once, and putting them on my fingers and saying, "Kuntal, now walk and clap as hard as you can." And he summited Everest in, you know, these local $5 gloves. And I summited Everest wearing his $200 mittens. And he did not even think for a second before giving me his mittens. And this is the kind of selfless support that put me on top of Everest. I'll kind of, you know, just... end it there. You folks can kind of follow me on Instagram. That is where I'm the most active, and I share my stories and my journey and my photos from my bodybuilding journey, from my mountaineering journey, all the time. I write about these stories and everything. I share photos. So feel free to reach out to me on Instagram, LinkedIn, WhatsApp, however you want to reach out to me. Happy to kind of take questions at the end of the session once we open up for question and answers. But that's kind of it from my side.
Well, Kuntal, thank you so much. Truly inspiring, truly amazing. Your story has so much of, you know, ups and lows and highs and, you know, downfalls. I think I'm quite kind of speechless. So what truly intrigues me is that this journey has not been a very long journey. Like, you know, anyone would say, you know, I've been in the adventure field for 20 years, 30 years, you know, gone through the entire Himalayan range, XYZ. You just started in 2009, you know, and very simply, humbly put, you wanted to see snow. And your first impact of the silence and the peace and what you felt within your side at the Hattu Peak, you know, journey, truly, I think, made all the difference. I saw your picture, you know, you really were, you know, something like 110, like you said, you know, and now with such a fit body and, you know, you're into passionate bodybuilding vegan way, I think it's absolutely fantastic, remarkable, you know. I have some takeaways from your talk show today, which I'd like to mention over here. When you said that, what's your Everest? So each one of us needs to ask, you know, ourselves, what's your Everest? And you rightly said that many of us, you know, would not even, you know, understand what's my Everest. But that's the question that we all need to ask. And that is how you transform your life. Top of the world, not only just body, but mind also. And that is what will, you know, make you understand the way forward. Your vegan way is very, very, you know, inspiring. I think not many of us would have even thought about it, but you've done it. And your own, you know, principles, the way you have tried to convince manufacturers across the world to create care the vegan way was really a story. So for me, I think, like you said, that hundreds of people have climbed Everest for sure, but the way you have done it and the way you hold your integrity and your passion, the vegan way, is what, you know, I'd really love in your show today. I wanted to ask you a question, you know, that why did you climb Everest the second time? You know, once you did from the south side, then you went to the north side. But now I got my, you know, answer to the question, you know, that you got a new, you know, equipment, which was the vegan equipment, and you wanted to test it. So you went, you know, to the north side, and that answered the question. One question I wanted to ask you is that being a passionate photographer and a great photographer, what kind of equipment do you use? Do you use a bulky DSLR, or do you use a GoPro, or what's your, you know, camera that you actually use for taking pictures?
So my preferred camera is definitely a bulky DSLR. Nothing beats a bulky DSLR. The kind of quality that you get in a DSLR, and when you want to blow up and actually make a print out of it, I don't think any phone camera on the planet or any GoPro on the planet and can rival that quality. That said, there's a lot of pros and cons of carrying a DSLR. I have never been able to carry a DSLR beyond 8,000 meters, unfortunately. The moment I get to 8,000 meters, things become much harder, and I have almost always dropped my DSLR at 8,000 meters. I do think that I need to train harder if I want to focus on becoming a mountaineering photographer and be able to carry my equipment much higher than that and still be able to shoot good photos, bring back quality photos. Because on my Lhotse climb, I have some absolutely spectacular summit shots and throughout the entire climb. But all of those shots have been taken by Mingma. And I gave Mingma my DSLR. And he had zero trouble, you know, just clicking away pictures. And he's not even a trained photographer. So his fitness is like unparalleled. So even if I can get to like 5% of Mingma's fitness, or even 10% of Mingma's fitness, I would truly do well as a mountaineering photographer. Unfortunately, that has never been my goal. So I do now think with better technological improvements, potentially a phone camera is great, because it at least allows you to still capture some moments and not be dependent on the DSLR. Or a GoPro, which you kind of just attach to your chest, or you attach to your kind of, you know, head, and just, you know, keep it on. Of course, you just have to manage the batteries well. That kind of becomes the challenge. But if I would have to do this all over again, I would just train harder, like much, much, much harder. And you rightly pointed out in the beginning that my journey has not been as long. But I truly believe that what I did differently is that I spent way, way, way too much time. In the last 10 years, if I have to kind of just count the number of hours, I think per day I would have easily spent 2 to 3 hours, or maybe even more, just executing my mountaineering dream. So if I kind of just look at an entire decade, I would have easily spent more than 10,000 plus hours just behind my mountaineering dream. This is just getting ready for the dream. I'm not even counting the hours I've spent on the mountain. So I truly believe for someone who wants to probably have a shorter journey, I'm not saying take a shortcut, but I'm just saying that if you want to have maybe a, you know, 5-year journey or a 7-year journey to top of Everest, you just have to put in more time. You just have to make it the number one priority of our life and kind of get, you know, kind of do it. But getting back to your mountaineering question, the photography question, I do think if I go back from a photography mindset, I will train much harder. I will become a better photographer on 6,000, 6,500, 7,000 peaks. Once I have enough confidence there, at that point, try a smaller 8,000er, get some good shots, get some good videos, and then potentially, you know, go a little higher. Can't take a shortcut here, because when you are taking a photo, imagine standing on a crevasse and having just 10 seconds to kind of take that photo, or, you know, being very mindful where, what risk you are going to take. So yeah, I'll just train differently, train much harder, and probably go back. But don't have any such ambitions at this point. I think the biggest mistake that I've seen a lot of my co-mountaineers make is that